Good evening, everybody. I hope everybody is doing well this Saturday evening. I hope everybody is having a good time. It's a nice showery weather here in Chennai. I think a lot of Chennaites have been finding the weather nice and wet. So I hope everybody is having a great Saturday. And I'm going to be joined by Gauri. And let's see if I can connect with her immediately. Okay, I don't have a request from her. Let me send her a request in white. We should have Gauri joining us immediately. We have another interesting session with her. Hey, Gauri, how are you doing?
Hi, Pratik. I am well. How are you?
I'm doing good. So, everybody, this is Gauri, the registered nutritionist, or as we like to call her, the registered rock star. Sorry, the registered dietitian. Let me correct myself there. And Hustling Muscles joining in. So, we're having another interesting session. It is getting more on the diet. Okay. So, Gauri, you know, there has been a lot of thing about diets, you know, sustainability, healthy lifestyle. We've been talking lots and lots to people out there, giving our point of view. Okay, this is what should be done. This is how it has to be done. So, you know, it's all about diets today. Okay, you know, what's your take? You know, is it digital diet or how? Why is this word diet has actually become diet? You know, why do you think so? You know, The world is taking a hit now. Suddenly, you know, experts are saying, okay, let's stay away from diets. Let's not get into all this bogus diet. Let's be realistic. Why is there a sudden shift? Why are people trying to, you know, I don't know, somehow not stick to the word diet, and they're changing the mind frame saying, okay, ditch the diet, stay to normal food. Give a little explanation. Why is this sudden shift?
You're right. It's you know, when you think of the word diet, everybody looks at the first three letters and like, diet. Think of it this way. There is not necessarily a shift in our perspective of, you know, how we're eating or going into the diet mode. I think most of it is coming down to reliving our traditional ways of eating. And our, you know, what we basically need to do in terms of healthy eating. The funny thing is, eating in a healthy manner has now come down to being a diet, which is, you know, in my perspective, very crazy. So a lot of the times, if there are no health implications for a client, a medical condition that we have to think about, they should be on a healthy nutrition plan or eating normal traditional foods. Nowadays, the new gurus and things are like, you know, we have to be on a diet, or there needs to be a diet control or a diet change and things like that. I don't think that's true. And I don't think, you know, using the word diet really helps. In our nomenclature, when we do this in terms of nutrition sciences, diets are modifications of healthy nutrition plans, so that a specific condition is taken care of or alleviated through that diet plan. So when you think about a diet, the first things I think about when it comes to diets is predominantly something that you need to talk to with diabetic clients, something you need to talk to with people with heart disease or high blood pressure. Those are the people who really require diets per se. There is a slew, there are tens and thousands of diets out there, and most of them work. And when we talk about diets, everybody thinks about, oh, you can't eat this or you can't eat that, or you have to change something majorly. The whole point is to go back to eating normal, healthy food, our traditional way of eating.
See, there's something that I think I've learned from you guys over the time, or, you know, what I've at least understood. A diet has to be sustainable and realistic. How true do you think that is?
Absolutely. See, a diet, I mean, now if you're talking, let's talk in the general sense, okay? When somebody doesn't have underlying medical conditions that, you know, that they don't know about, and, you know, they're healthy in the medical nomenclature of it. And when we're talking about basic nutrition eating plan, when we modify something in that and we make it specialized to us, it should be sustainable. Yes, sustainable meaning you can do this every day, and if need be, those modifications can be tweaked to tweak to your specific situation, your lifestyle, your environment, your traditional ways of eating, the way your family eats together. Those are the things that you really need to take into consideration when you're talking about sustainability. Because I know if I give a client something that is completely off and completely different, even if they don't especially if they don't have a let's just take weight loss as the base level thing when we talk about this. No medical condition, somebody who has weight, wants to do weight loss and says, I really want to lose weight. And you give them something very stringent that is completely out of the way of what their family is eating or what they're preparing for their family. That's going to be very difficult to stick to. And when we say we want people to stick to something and sustain it through their lives, when we talk about sustainability, people don't think, people think about it, oh, 6 months ke liye ho jayega, you know, I'll reach my goal and I'll be sorted. No, 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 no. We doesn't talk about, when, yeah.
Okay, I think we are having connection issues, so she'll be joining. But yeah, that's the whole thing, you know, especially if you look at home, when it comes to, you say at a housewife or a mom, she can't cook a separate meal for one particular person. If there are 4 or 5 people at home, you have to cook, you know, for everybody. You just can't have specific diets. I can understand if you're a sports person, if you're an athlete, or you're an, you know, your profession requires that, or your medication or your physical illness or something requires that. So maybe that time, you know, something like that can be catered to. But otherwise, you have to be realistic. You have to be. And nowadays, modernized world, and you know, the way we guys are moving forward with everybody working, you don't have time for all this. Okay, Gauri, now moving to my next question. Okay. Now, see, there is this sudden change where I see a lot of, you know, in my terms, I would say a lot of foreign things have come into the market. You know, over the years, okay, our breakfast tables have been conquered by cornflakes, oats, millets, and you know, so on and so on. Okay, some are very much Indian, some are very much international, some are Indianly international, I should say. And you know, suddenly modern gurus are saying, I've just heard this, I've just spoken to people, so I wanted to check with you, that things like dal, chapati, our Indian food is not good, we should stay off it. Okay. And yeah, then my niece is, I think, putting in the comments, bacon. Yeah, Zalia, that's for both of us and nobody else. Let the bacon stay there.
Okay. All right. Okay. This is fantastic. I mean, I am zapped that you're even suggesting something, or somebody would even suggest
it's
something.
Not me, the modern fitness guru. I'm not a fitness guru.
Okay. All right. So let me be point blank here. Okay, that's rubbish. Okay, when we are in a particular place, like we live in India, and most of our friends who are joining us I live in India. Those who are abroad are looks like Indian makeup right now. Yay. But what it all comes down to, no matter which place you're from, the best nutrition that you can get is by adopting your nutritional plan or your daily nutritional lifestyle as per the place you're in. So you're looking at traditional cultures. We've grown up with cultural basis for our foods. There are traditions behind our foods. Our system, our long thousands of year old system of Ayurveda encourages us to basically to eat what is locally grown and locally sourced, because that has the maximum nutritional requirements that you can meet with for your body. So this thing about bringing in new food, yes, there can be new food fusions. Things still, when we say new food fusions, trying it, incorporating it in your diet, if it does have a better nutritional impact for you, that's great. But we don't move away from our thing. Suppose, say Prateek, you decide to get up today and you like, I'm going to go to America and I'm going to live there. You will basically be eating foods. You will basically be eating foods that are available there. But all said and done, you come from a cultural background. You come from a lifestyle that you're used to, or foods that are you're used to, and that's what you will gravitate towards. And you know, you even when you're there, you will source locally. But the final preparations will most likely be what you know. You know, your desi food, and that's what does you the best nutritional value. That gives you the best nutritional value. So,
the boiled eggs and cheese in America also.
Yeah, I mean, yeah, we got them too.
No, that's a good point you've put. And I think Dr. Mukherjee has also added, I can see in the comments, sustainability is needed. So I think everybody agrees with us. Okay, moving on. Okay, somebody asked me other day, you know, people who have a sweet tooth, okay, a lot of people have a sweet tooth. You have a weakness for everything. Like I have a weakness for beer. Okay. Right. Everybody has a weakness for something. Is it necessary to give it up? I again repeatedly ask you this. Why does it become so specific? Nowadays, I'm also hearing you have to stop eating fruits because fruits has sugar in it. I know you would want to start a fight, Gauri, but no, this is not a place. We need an explanation for you at the moment.
All right. I think I'm going to send you those reels with my face on it.
It's already up there.
I know. Okay. Let's get down to the basics of it. Okay. When you're talking about, unless you have a specific medical condition that requires you to have a major modification where certain foods are taken out or are restricted. That is the only place I see where your restrictions are valid most of the time. Okay. And this is under medical nutrition guidance. So that's what we call medical nutrition therapy. And when we do that, say for a diabetic, and we usually, you know, we are very steadfast in telling them that enjoying your carbohydrates, even though they give, you know, increase your blood sugars. How to do it? What kind of carbohydrates are we looking at? So we're looking at complex carbohydrates, not simple things like sugar. So, you know, those things, and even sugar is not completely taken out for all diabetics. So there are certain things we have to look at when we say blatant statements like that. And you know, it's not required for the general healthy population. So when you look at people, you know, say you love your beer, okay? And we've been through this so many times. You've asked me multiple times, do I need to give up my beer? No, as a healthy, otherwise healthy individual, considering your goals, considering what you were looking to achieve, we counted that beer into your regular schedule because you like your beer and you know you're a party guy and you're going to drink your beer. So taking that into consideration, that is important. Had you had a medical issue, we would have taken the medical issue as a precedent over your beer. I mean, let's be frank. There are certain conditions you can't do that in. Yeah. And then we would have given you that. I would have said that, you know, Pratik, listen, this is what it is. And you know, maybe you can restrict it or you may have to take it out. And there's an explanation to that. So when we do this in terms of medical nutrition therapy, it is extremely valid when you take out certain foods, not necessarily food groups. Okay. But in the general healthy population, it's not required to give up your favorite foods.
Okay, so putting this in a nutshell for everybody out there, guys, see, this is where, even when I did my last session with Dr. Mukherjee, I put this out towards the end. See, this is where you make the difference between a qualified, you know, a person with that educational degree with nutrition, physiotherapy, etc., who come with solid knowledge over the years, over somebody giving you a crash course. Okay, somebody doing a crash course and giving you knowledge. Here is where you mark the difference. So that is why, as she says, as she's explained, it is not necessary. Even for certain diabetics, as she was saying, it is not necessary they remove all the sugar. These guys understand things in such details. So this is something you guys should learn from and keep in mind when you choose a fitness expert, like I always say. So I think Gauri is still having a little bit of network trouble. I think she's traveling, so she's having a bit of a network trouble, and she's going to be joining us back. So don't worry, I'm not going to bore you for that long. But yes, as I was explaining, choosing your fitness expert, choosing how your right fitness expert is very, very important. I know there are so many out there, but don't go by your fitness person's experience. Don't go by their looks. Go by their experience, the knowledge they have, the transformations they've done over the years. Okay, I think Gauri should be joining us now. Okay, she's back. Gauri, you are.
Sorry, yeah, I'm in the car.
Okay,
yeah.
Now I'm going to quickly go on to our next question. How do we keep, you know, our eating habits? You've already explained quite a bit of it. How do we keep these natural or, you know, these healthy eating habits long lasting and sustainable?
So let's come back to what healthy eating habits are or healthy eating is. Healthy eating is basically what you are used to doing over your entire lifetime. So, I mean, for a 20-year-old, when you're eating your mom's home-cooked food, that is your healthy eating. Yes, if you're eating fried foods and things like that, that is a part of that. It doesn't mean you have to take it out. Okay, healthy eating also includes fried foods and things like that in a specific amount, small portioned amounts. So taking all that into consideration, it's actually easier to stick to a healthier eating pattern or stuff that is done at home than it is to do, you know, eat foods from outside or order in from outside, because you're left with so many choices that you have to figure out what is the right choice, right? So those are the things that you have to take into consideration. And how is it sustainable? Basically depends on your health goals. Now, if you're looking at losing weight or losing, you know, having some sort of a change in your physical outcome or a medical outcome, there is, like you explained, you know, go to a nutrition professional. They will guide you on how to do that. But if you're looking at it from with no medical issues there, then you're looking at, you know, just making small tweaks. 90% of the time, those small tweaks come across in the portion size itself. It doesn't have to be a huge change. It doesn't have to be, oh, I'm going to take out this entire food group and I'll be healthy. It doesn't work that way, because we're used to eating certain, you know, all food groups from all, you know, from what you have available in your house. And the last point in this, I would say, again, locally sourced, locally grown foods. Go local. I mean, go to your local grocers, buy local foods, buy foods that are readily available. I think one of the things that you mentioned earlier on was millets and things like that. India actually is one of the powerhouses and one of the foremost growers of millet. We used to grow millet in huge quantities. That went down and, you know, that got replaced by predominantly by wheat and rice. But saying we're going back to millet is not right, because that is our traditional way of eating. So we should basically be eating our traditional foods that are really good for us.
So I think what I would add to this is very simple. See, guys, it has to be on your liking. If you're going to force yourself to eat things like, I'm not a person who can eat oats very often. It's not something I really like in the morning. I'm not a person who can eat millets in the morning. But yes, I don't mind eating boiled egg. I don't mind eating, you know, a nice cucumber sandwich, things like that. So it is up to you to make your choices.
Hold on. Pratik, do you like ragi?
No.
No? Because that's a millet. If you like ragi, you're in South India. So a lot.
I know ragi. Yeah. See, I would any day eat idli. Chalega. No problem.
That's rice and pulse, but that's okay.
even the international bodybuilders, the rice cake.
The rice cakes, yeah. Well, yeah. Okay.
So now moving on to the next. Okay. A lot of people do crash courses. The biggest crash course I can remember since I started working in the fitness industry is the GM diet. Okay. The GM diet been one diet I think anybody and everybody who's tried to lose weight has had a, you know, what we say, touch on, or you know, they have, you know, tried it. I know so many people. Why do these crash course diets not work? Why do they end up fading away at times? And what I mean to say is, no, listen to me. What I mean to say is they show results, but then when you go off it, they come back. Why?
Absolutely. So see, crash courses, if you're taking a crash course, take something in education. Don't take it in your diet. Okay, that's my first piece of advice here. Do a crash course in an education subject. Okay.
Not a fitness subject.
Not a fitness. Yeah. A crash course doesn't work in your food. It does not work in your fitness. You need to go through a very specific program or a long-lasting program. And there is no shortcut in food and no shortcut in fitness.
We want to know the outcome. Why does the weight come back? That has been the punchline.
So what happens with, there are tens, I've already said this, there are 10,000 diets out there, all of which work. Okay. Many of these work and they work really well. But the problem is majority of these diets are based on elimination. When you eliminate a food, and most of them are based on elimination of a food group, not just one or two foods. So that's a big chunk of what you're eating is taken out. Okay. Now let's just take into consideration the low carb or zero carb diet, no carb diet. Okay. If I'm taking out carbohydrates, which make up about 50 to 55% of my diet. Okay. And I take that out completely. What happens? You've immediately cut down your caloric density by 50%. So you will definitely see the results. You get what I'm saying? You just cut down, you know, numbers don't lie. So you cut down the amount of food and you cut down the type of food, you're definitely in deficit and you're going to see the results. But now, how long can you sustain not eating a slice of bread or your dosa or your idli? You know, how long can you do that? If you can sustain it for a long time, great. But again, that's still not healthy because it's not giving you your energy package. That's what carbs are meant for. When you stop the diet and you reintroduce the eliminated food group, you are adding the calories.
Okay.
I really can't
stop laughing on this because I'm going through a transformation phase myself where Gauri knows I'm on a strict diet. So I'm going to be going through this phase where I've eliminated so many food groups to reach one particular stage and I'm going to come back to where I am. I know that. So I'm honestly doing this as an experiment to share my damn experience with everybody that what happened when I did this and what happened when I came out. You know, do it on yourself to learn.
See, if you have a very specific goal, like you do right now, I know what your goal is and I know where what you're trying to get to, what that physical outcome you want. And you're doing this for that, to attain that. But if you know that where your baseline was when you started that diet, like right now, like a week ago before you started it, you knew where you were. And then you know once you get off that diet and you've achieved what you wanted to achieve, yay. But then once you get back on, you have to ensure that once you're on and things change, the body changes, you will have to go back to your baseline. And your baseline can't be 2020. The baseline has to be a week ago. That's the issue. That's why a lot of people realize it doesn't work to eliminate a lot of things. You know, those modifications have to be very specific. And they have to be
you learn it with experience, Gauri. So I would really say that.
Yeah, that's true. That is okay. True.
Now I'm coming back to, since we've understood the sustainability part, my next question to you. Okay, I've already said, okay, there's this lot of, you know, I don't know, foreign food that's suddenly in the market, the healthy snacks, try this, try that. One something that I've kept hearing about, Greek yogurt. Okay, I see. I see everybody. I see a lot of guys, enthusiasts keep putting up on the stories, Greek yogurt, you guys have to try this. See, if there's only any yogurt I would like to try, it's very simple. Going back to my childhood, it's Mishti Doi. I still remember as a kid when I had this short stint with my parents in Calcutta. We used to get in that, you know, matkas, small matkas. Right. Used to get right. It in. Okay. The authentic taste, the sweet and everything. And I don't know. If I had to choose a yogurt, I would say I would rather go that. What is the difference between, you know, a Mishti Doi, the natural Mishti Doi made with this Greek yogurt? Why is this Greek yogurt getting so much importance? Is it just the brand element? Or does it actually have some magical thing which is going to make you boom?
Well, we like the Greeks, right? So that's probably one part of it. But when you go and look at the basic product itself, okay, Greek yogurt is a concentrated form, and there are certain benefits that they do have a whole amount of, a lactobacilli and other good bacteria that are great for your gut health. But so does regular dahi. Yeah. And that's available to us everywhere here right now. We make dahi at home, and Greek yogurt happens to be a little bit more concentrated because the whey or the water content is reduced. And we can achieve the same thing by just hanging regular curd. So hung curd is also, so as long as you're not making it into a tight ball, hung curd, which is used for many sweets. Hung curd and in its natural form is actually similar to Greek yogurt, and it actually has the same kind of protein benefits, has the same nutrient benefits, has the same healthy gut bacteria benefits. So it's there. Right now, I think we're on this, like probably like you said, on the stint of, you know, having foreign foods come in just because it says Greek or American or this or that, you know. I think that's it. I'm coming to Mishti Doi. Mishti Doi is, I have to say, I personally love Mishti Doi, especially when it comes in that matka. It is basically a sweetened form of dahi, and it's great. But because it's sweetened, it's also made with concentrated milk. So when we're talking about concentrated...
Gauri, sorry to interrupt, but I'm in the comment section. So I think you have somebody who wants to get educated. So is it all about marketing, Gauri? Even I'm asking you now.
More or less. I right now, if you have yogurt available, we all make dahi at home. Okay. As Indians, we are good at making dahi at home. We know the basic mechanisms that go into it. When you talk about things like Greek yogurt and this yogurt and flavored yogurt, yeah, they are all marketing gimmicks because they come in those individual pack sizes, and it's convenience food, and all said and done, it is a processed food. So that is something that you have to really look at, in terms of, do you want to fall for the marketing of it, or do you think you can get the same thing at home naturally?
Zaria, you can have a shift from, you know, all the natural things. Maybe you can start convincing your mothers to start making natural cakes and baking stuff like that.
So think of it this way. Everything that is minimally processed or unprocessed is actually the healthy component of your healthy diet. Okay. So having dahi as a minimally processed product is basically what is going to help, so many nutrient absorption. Calcium is better absorbed through dahi than it is through liquid milk. So, you know, there are different ways of doing it. But look at foods that are minimally processed or unprocessed as majority of your healthy diet. Hmm. Yeah.
Okay. So now let's move on to the next question that I have. There are a lot of things they say, cut fats, cut sugar, reduce salt. And this is the best healthy advice that's going around in the market suddenly. I don't know why a lot of people have said, ki namak khana chhod do. I don't know how honestly is that true. I don't understand people. Do people understand the difference between good fat, bad fats? I know people put up nuts is good fat. This is bad fat. Okay. And sugar. I don't know why sugar is becoming the public enemy number one suddenly, you know. So
It's not suddenly. I'll be very honest. Sugar is not becoming a public enemy suddenly. It has been shown that it is a highly processed product. So sugar, from my perspective, yes, I would agree with that. Even for a healthy individual with no medical background issues, I would say minimize your intake of table sugar and, processed sugar. Having said that, even jaggery that we use in regular cooking is processed, but it does have certain nutrients in it because it is in a partially processed, it's a partially processed product. So it gives you B vitamins, you've got iron coming through that and a lot of other nutrients that you get through with the sweetening effect. So that is a, an alternative you can turn to. But if you're watching, if you're looking at weight loss and things like that, then the biggest issue you are going to have is a caloric load. So straight off, I agree with the sugar component. Processed sugar, take it out or minimize it. That's one. Second thing, said salt. Salt. So salt is one of the biggest things for salt is when you, for people with primary hypertension is when, they have certain sodium potassium shifts happen in their system and their blood pressure rises because of that and their internal structure. The basic thing that a lot of people are saying don't have salt because salt has other, for healthy individuals, I don't think that's necessary, overtly necessary. But for people who do have underlying medical conditions, simple one is hypertension that, follow your DASH diet. That is something that I would definitely suggest. People who have cardiac issues, reduce your salt. That always helps. Other conditions like kidney conditions and things like that, they do have to have salt restrictions. But is it great to have a salt restrictions across the board for everybody? I don't think so. No. Salt is essential for our diets.
And what about fats?
Ah, that's the thing. Everybody wants to cut out fat. They want low fat this, fat free that, and things like that. Fat is good. Fat is good in a specific amount. Eating fat, so I had a question today. What is the difference between homemade ghee and store-bought ghee? And base level answer to that is nothing. Okay, one is made in the store, one is made in a factory, one is made in the house. Finally, if you're looking at the components of that ghee, it's going to be the same. It is a pure fat. It is a it's a fat that you use that has a flavoring, a base level flavoring, and it's also good for you in specific quantities. Then again, you talked about good fat versus bad fat. This is something that a lot of people don't get is good fat. Let's come to bad fat. Bad fat does certain things to your system. Certain things to your system that make it not possible to continue its use. Whereas good fat actually help your system to get healthier. But again, fat is fat. Whether it's good or it's bad, and they all have the same amount of calories. So, having a portioned amount of fat in your health, diet is extremely important. So I see there's okay, yeah, we're back to the marketing question, looks like.
So anyway, okay, listen, I'm going to ask you my last and final question. Now, this is a very tricky question, Gauri. Mm-hmm. I don't know how you're going to answer this, but this is going to be a very tricky question. Eating healthy, eating clean, the new age fitness gurus, but they're eating healthy, eating clean is, fat nikal do, don't eat fruits, sugar hota hai. Okay, dals don't have protein, it's only carbs, carbohydrate. Okay,
oh my gosh.
And so on is the new fitness gurus that are saying, your protein intake has to be completed by scoops of whey and whey and whey, things like that. Now, all this sort of diets that people start taking, okay, I'm saying this new age type of diet, okay, remove the salt totally, bland food, blah, blah, blah. Can this lead to an eating disorder amongst the young adults today? A very serious question.
Yeah, it is a serious question because eating disorders are have a lot to do with perspective. So when we
Because why
talk,
I asked you this before you start off, sorry to interrupt. I read
that's okay.
something the other day. I was researching something, so I was reading something. A lot of people who've been putting into certain fasting modes, especially at a younger age, have had tendency where they say this fasting is going to start affecting their waistline. It's not going to reduce it, it'll start increasing it. And their insulin levels have a hit. Whereas what happens is their capacity to stay hungry and and the entire metabolism gets hit, which basically ends up making them, stay hungry and just keeping on putting on weight. How do you address this? Is it true? How do you address this to young adults who are getting into this fasting mode?
See, fasting is great as a you know it's a self-disciplinary mode that we go into for a few days for religious reasons for just feeling good about ourselves. Yeah, it's great once in a blue moon, but on a regular basis, a lot of so I'm gonna break this down into two, three different parts. Okay, the first thing we'll go back for a few thousand years, and according to Ayurveda, the entire premise of fasting was to be to have it to cleanse your system. So when you fasted, there were a specific type of food that you ate that helped in cleaning your digestive system because, as per Ayurveda, most of your medical issues culminate from your stomach. Having said that, people now are using the same ideology but twisting it around to prolong that fasting process. Fasting processes are not supposed to be prolonged for more than a day, max two, depending on why you're doing that fast. And the primary reason for the fasting used to be discipline. Whether you could discipline yourself. So what that bringing that into the modern era and teaching young kids and young adolescents and young adults this is it's there are two ways of looking at this. One, the disordered eating is this is not how we were meant to eat. We are not meant to be sustaining a fasting diet for a long period of time. That does screw up our system, like you said, insulin resistant. You have higher cortisol levels. You have so many things going on that it is difficult to balance that those hormonal changes in your system to give you the results you're looking for. And people are using it for the wrong reasons. So this is definitely a disordered eating. And its secondary thing is also on the opposite end of it, where young teenage girls and boys nowadays are thinking, that's my control point. I can control what I eat, how I eat it, and all those things so that, I can achieve something for myself. That's my control point for myself. And that too is disordered eating. And we're seeing a lot more of these people, clients nowadays. And it's pretty alarming how people are just, having major issues with
Falling for the trap.
this. Sorry?
I said falling for the trap.
Falling for the trap. It is falling for the trap. It again, I'm going to go back to my that same sentence I'm saying. Healthy eating. If we're looking at healthy, clean eating, it is primarily unprocessed foods or processed, minimally processed foods or foods that are as give you the best nutrition options even after they've been processed. So things like pulses, because they're dried, pulses and grains are dried, they are considered processed foods, but they give you nutrition, that you require for your body. So there's a lot of information out there that has been taken it's been taken really wrongly and can adversely affect a lot of people. So you're right. I mean, disordered eating, yes, it can possibly lead to that.
Okay, I think we've given a quite a bit of information today. Okay, and I think you're joining us from your car today, if I'm not wrong. Okay, how do I see two cops
Yes, I
approaching you from
am.
behind? No, two
Nah,
cops
Baba.
approaching you.
I have mirrors, remember?
If you draw
Ah,
mirrors,
Prithvi,
don't
I'm
look
not
well.
falling for that one.
I think you know me too well for that. But anyway,
I know you well enough.
yeah, I think we've given a lot of information today. It's been a very, very value-adding conversation that we've had, especially on the diets people are following. I know a lot of people out there are struggling with their weight the way I have struggled. You know, it is about finding the right person, finding the right mode and things like that. Those things count a lot, okay? So, you know,
Absolutely.
it's something where people have to realize. I know intermittent fasting is becoming a trend and things like that. But as I read, you know, with the insulin levels and things like that, and personally having a look at people who are, you know, been having trouble. So that is why I wanted to ask this question towards the end. So we've given a lot of details. Guys, this video is going to be anyways up on our accounts. So you guys can very much have a look if you guys want to whenever you grew. I hope you guys enjoy the video. There's a lot of information Gauri has given out. And again, guys, thank you so much. Thank you so much for your time. And Gauri, again, thank you. Thank you for your time. Thank you for all the knowledge that you've shared. So guys, so that's it for today. That's it for this session. So we're going to be back again next week. And we'll have another interesting session between Gauri and me. So again, thank you, Gauri. Thank you so much for your time.
Thank you.
It was a pleasure.
Thank you.
So guys, this is Gauri and this is Hustling Muscles signing off. Thank you so much, guys. Take care.
Bye.